variance and what have you, but I don't think the sewer issue, as far as your RC zone, should be an issue in it. It might be an issue at this point, but 10 years down the road, 5 years down the road, I hope this would still be on the books, and there might be adequate sewer available at that time.
Okay, Doug?
I think I made the motion. I'm not sure when I made it. So would it be reasonable to accept a compromise on this point if we were to include, as you reread section 6, to include somehow in the terminology that it'd be 75% of that currently required in an RA zone, which would apply also to an
RC
zone.
RC, yes, that's it. Okay. Minimum lot size as it exists in the RC zone being 75%. Somehow putting that in your wording or in your phrase under section 6. That would address your concern. It would address a concern that I guess been swayed to believe is a real concern.
And I can count heads too.
Well, yeah, but I mean, I have no pressing engagement after this meeting.
None of us would. It'll be 1 a.m.
Would that be a reasonable compromise to get this thing moving? And if it is, I'll make that amendment to my motion. And I'm sure Frank will, if he seconded, I can't remember. I'll make that amendment, and you people can worry on the terminology.
I would second that amendment.
Okay. All right. An amendment has been offered and seconded. Is there a discussion of that amendment?
That's what it is.
I'd like to ask Phyllis and Alice to respond to that suggested amendment. Would that help you in any way to at least have this minimum lot size in an RC zone?
As it applies to an RC zone, it would apply in an RA and in every zone, but as it's based on the zoning requirements or on the space requirements in an RC zone, I don't even know if it's.
I'm not familiar with the square acreage of all the older RA homes. It used to be 40,000 square feet?
Used to be, yep. Yes.
So.
Just prior to 20,000 square feet, just after.
Just after, and now it's 80.
Okay, then, to even make it easier, would it be to have 15,000 square feet of lot size for each additional unit? That's what it breaks down to.
In the RC zone?
All zones. Just to put 15,000 square feet instead of 75% of an RC zone, which is 20,000, 75% of that is 15,000.
But that doesn't apply to an RA then?
It would apply equally to an RA and an RC, just to put the 15,000 square feet in.
All right. I just don't understand how it applies. I understand clearly how it applies to the RC. Explain to me how that applies to the RA.
Well, it would just be consistent in your conversion in RC and RA, where right now it would not be consistent because you'd be at your quad of 1.4 acres.
Yeah.
And you have a problem with that. I guess I do too. But if we just break it down so that it's 3/4 of the required space in an RC zone, that's 15,000 square feet. Just put 15,000 square feet per dwelling unit.
Okay. Yeah.
That I see.
Per dwelling unit?
Well, however that's worded. You gave a much better rendition of 6 than was before me.
Could you dwelling
per convert? Phyllis, do you want to come to the podium?
I wish I'd known about your previous meeting to work this all out that night. Perhaps in saying 15,000 square feet, you're not distinguishing between the residential zones, so that might not be considered discriminatory. But you would have to consider if at some point where you want to increase the sizes of your residential areas that you zones, you may need to change that square footage, and the RC requirement would float if you did increase the RC at some later date. I'm not sure about the distinguishing between one or the other. Perhaps 15,000 square feet would be the best way to address it at the moment. That way you're not discriminating against one zone and not against another. It'd be equal.
I would change the, I mean, I'm willing to change the amendment if you're, if that's what you're proposing, for the sake of...
Well, I don't want to rush it through either. I'm just trying to think of something that's reasonable for both zoning districts. And I think it's unreasonable to require 1.4 acres in an RA zone. I don't know that it's unreasonable to require 15,000 square feet in either zone. I'm concerned about some of the big homes on, as the example was in Shore Road, being converted, massively converted, without any restrictions. So I don't know if the 15,000 would be a reasonable compromise to get it going. If it doesn't work, we can always refine it. I mean, if we run up against the problem, then we can readdress that issue.
I second your motion. Move the question.
Okay, but let's make sure everybody understands it.
Okay.
All right, we are voting out on an amendment which would require 15,000 square feet for a conversion.
Now, can we vote?
Now, that's not the exact language. We're planning to use the language that Phyllis had come up with, but...
Perhaps she could come up with that.
For each dwelling unit.
I would...
Yeah, per additional dwelling unit.
I would suggest that the council have a consensus-type vote, and then during an upcoming break, we work out the language, and then you actually take a vote if you do want to approve this amendment, so that we feel very comfortable with the language and we actually are approving the exact language.
Is it appropriate to do that? Is that too much of a change from the public hearing format? I mean, legally...
We don't understand the question.
No, that's not it. Legally, we presented an amendment for public hearing. The public has spoken on that amendment. We are allowed to make some changes. This is a fairly great change, but so I'm ready to move the question and vote on it. I just want to make sure you're comfortable.
On the same token, the public doesn't know anything about this that came in from Leahy tonight. Either.
But those do not change the sense of the ordinance.
I don't know what they do.
And we have a legal opinion, which is Order. Yes.
We are now going to vote on the proposed amendment. And we will actually see the language in the official language, but this is a consensus vote on whether we agree with adding this to the revisions being proposed.
I agree with consensus.
All those in favor of the amendment?
Consensus.
Consensus. We're not...
Right.
This is not a vote.
Right. This is a consensus. Any opposed? Okay. All right. Now, we are back to the main motion, which was to approve the recommendations of the ordinance committee with... Now, with this additional consensus, the wording to be added at a later time. All those in favor of that motion?
May I ask what we're using now?
We
this mixed in with the other?
We can't do that.
Why not?
Because we now need to just make a motion to delay this until the verbiage can be brought forward to us. Just delay it two or three items. We can't vote on accepting the amendment until we have the
All
verbiage.
Right. Okay.
So could we just voted consensus to put it off. So if
All
we
right.
could just vote, if we could just agree to delay it.
Okay.
I move we table this until later on.
Second.
No. All those in favor? Any opposed?
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Now,
can we have a recess after we vote on this?
Yes.
Well, it would be appropriate to have a recess if they could refine the language we had
voted. But after that.
Okay, item three is item 126, which is to consider approving a full-time malt and vintage license for the Good Table. Michael?
I'd just like to report the police department, it's been a long evening, has looked into this license, sees no reason that it should not be approved, did the usual checks, and found that it was fully in order. This is for Lisa Costopoulos doing business as the Good Table.
I move that we approve the license.
Is there a second?
Second. Uh-huh.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion carries 7-0. Thank you for being so patient.
Now we're going to go down to the Good Table and have a drink.
I move that we recess for 10 minutes.
All right. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? All right. We will recess for 10 minutes. We'll re-adjourn at 10 o'clock. Reconvene at 10 o'clock. I wish we'd adjourn.
Good job, right along. Figure we'll be out here at 4:15. We haven't got to the hot issue yet.
I know.
first page.
And we have to remove from the table, that's what we have to say.
So move.
Wait a minute, we're not, we haven't started yet. Ready? Okay. This regular monthly meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council is now again in session. At this time, I believe we are ready to reconsider item number 125. Would someone like to move that be taken from the table?
So move.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, I have the new wording for what would be item number 7 under the proposed revisions to the conversion of multi-unit dwellings. And I'm speaking of this, it's number 7 on this sheet right here.
Oh, 6 on the other one?
Yeah. Okay?
Okay.
This is the June 3rd, 87 draft. Okay, the proposed language would read, a minimum lot size of at least 15,000 square feet shall be necessary for conversion and documentation of which shall be supported by an accurate survey of the lot in question.
Move we adopt the amendment.
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? Yes, Lester.
Yeah, you're going to advertise this to the public, this change that you're making? This was put out to a public hearing, and I assume that you had certain wording that went out to the public. I'm wondering, with these changes, are you going to let the public know about it so they could have input?
The quality of the amendment, the ordinance has not changed. To go from 75%, change the wording around to 15,000 square feet. I'm not sure that we are allowed by law to make certain changes, and I don't think that this is enough of a change to have to reset it again for public hearing.
Well,
there's one, she made a mistake.
Yeah, this was not set for public hearing as including that language of the 75%. It was set for public hearing, eliminating that whole item.
Oh, that's right, okay, yeah.
So Lester is right that this item has not really been, as presented, has not been discussed at public hearing. The question is whether it is a major enough change to have to go through the process again. And that's an item that we'll have to decide. Yes,
I'd like to ask the town manager his opinion on the question you just raised. For the first time tonight, I think I have to agree with Councilor Jordan.
Another lightning bolt.
I think it is a substantive change. It particularly, you look at that, it's making something more restrictive rather than less restrictive. And it's certainly something that the public, I would think the town attorney would rule if he was here, something that the public should have an opportunity to comment upon.
Yeah, I was going to vote against the ordinance anyway.
There isn't a motion for the verbiage on the floor now, is there?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's what's voting.
There is a motion to amend the revisions to include this language.
Okay. Could the person who made that motion make that motion and also say, and set this for a public hearing on whatever the calendar date is?
Mm-hmm.
Who made the motion?
I did.
Would you be willing to include
and
the public?
Set it for August 13th?
August 10th.
10th? Is that our next meeting?
Okay. And who seconded that motion?
I did. Point of clarification then. Are we setting for the public hearing just this section and the rest will be adopted tonight, or will all of it now go back to public hearing?
Well, I'd like to see it all go back so that I could see what it looks like. I don't know what you've got.
I'd like to vote we vote in the amendment then and set the whole thing to a public hearing as opposed to adoption.
Okay. All right, then we can vote for this amendment, and after that, if that motion passes, we could vote to send the whole group of revisions to public hearing at the up next meeting in August. All right? Okay, right now we're voting only on the amendment. All those in favor? Okay. That motion carries 7-0.
To post it to public hearing on August 10th.
All of the revisions?
All of the revisions.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Okay, that motion also carries unanimously. Item 127, to consider a report from the Commissioner of the Maine Department of Transportation on preferred alternatives for replacement of the Portland Bridge. If you would like, I could recommend that we table that until next month due to time constraints, and also due to the fact that, well, Michael and I had a meeting with Commissioner Connors, in which he gave us his proposed, recommended alternative. I did ask him at that time if he would please forward to me so that all of the council could see what those recommendations were. And I haven't as yet received that information. So if you would just assume wait till you all are in receipt of that information, we could table this until next month.
I move that we table it until next month.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Only a question. Is there any need for ratification or the report? I mean, is there any action that we're going to take on it anyway other than to understand it, hopefully?
We could support his recommendation.
So far, what we say or accept or support hasn't amounted to Tinker's Dam anyway. I think we could.
But I really think you probably wouldn't want to support his recommendation until you saw the specifics of it.
Council Swartz might not want a recommendation. He's the one that's going to decide. Move the question.
Okay. All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that motion carries 7-0 to table. Item 128, to consider granting a quit claim deed to Parker Brown for land and buildings situated on Fowler Road. And Michael has some further information he wants to add to that quit claim request.
The Parker Brown property is located R6-26 over on Fowler Road. Taxes have not been paid on the property since 1977. The including 1988 taxes, which we have to collect in advance because they weren't committed as of April 1 because it was actually owned by the town, there's a total tax, including 88, owed of $11,512.46. In addition to that, interest is owed of $6,244, including charges, other miscellaneous, $17,762.68. Interest is accruing at the rate of $5.93 per day. This land is a very important part of what Dr. Rand would like to see as part of our greenbelt. He's had a number of discussions, Dr. Rand, as well as other members of the Conservation Commission, with the prospective buyer of this property, as well as with the broker involved. The Conservation Commission has not had any specific discussions with Mr. Brown, to my knowledge, on this. At the other evening, Thursday evening, when Dr. Rand went over the new greenbelt plan, it showed more clearly going through this property other than it did a week or so ago. He did suggest that perhaps, you know, it might be in the interest of the town to continue discussions with the Shelleys before the quit claim is granted. To see if something might be able to worked out. The Shelleys are the prospective owners. Thus far, as I understand, the Shelleys could speak for themselves. The comments have been fairly positive back and forth. There seems to be a real willingness to work together. One thing I would like to point out is that Mr. Brown, as well as the Shelleys, would like to have the closing in early August. And you know, I would hope that, you know, if you don't want to take final action on this tonight, pending the Greenbelt discussion, you would schedule that workshop prior, that this discussed in a later item, prior to the time that they have their closing, so that, you know, everything would be in order, so that wouldn't hold up their closing at all. You know, it is an unusual process that, you know, usually these things are granted automatically, but, you know, we have held this land for a particularly long time, and it is something that the Conservation Commission would like to have continued discussions with the prospective property owner on.
Yes, Councilor Dodd.
If we delay this, they're going to have to pay the additional penalty, $5.93 a day.
They didn't
because
plan
of our action of delaying.
No, because they didn't plan to pay this until the day of the closing anyway, so it would have been be the same interest up to that date.
Michael, when did you say the closing was going to be?
When is the closing?
Parker Brown has purchased the property and sold it to a
before the 10th?
Yes,
I had heard from the real estate agent somewhere the 6th or the 7th.
Yes. If we vote on this to agree to grant the deed, can we do that tonight so you can have your information available? So when the closing, whatever day the closing comes, you will be able to give them the deed and collect your money?
You know, if you authorize me to grant the quitclaim without conditions, you know, that could happen, no problem. If you wanted to put any conditions on it, you know, such as a satisfactory agreement with the Conservation Commission, you know, I would think, you know, no matter what the Conservation Commission came up with, the council itself would want to have the final say on that.
I don't want to grant you the condition of whatever the Conservation Commission has. I might want to look at that, so we've got to hold it to our next council meeting then.
No, we could schedule a special meeting after our workshop if we wanted to act upon it.
What's the date of this workshop?
We haven't scheduled it yet.
We're going to schedule one before the end of the month?
Yes. We're going to try to. Yes, Doug?
I don't know why we're even talking about something like this. I mean, we're not in partners, or we don't hold anything over Parker Brown other than an unpaid tax bill. We haven't put any liens on the property that I'm aware of. If we are, then we've seized the property, and then we can act as an intermediate in a transaction. But I think we're going to set an unfriendly precedent that if we screw up the sale of this, we could be held liable for it. I don't think the council has the right to step in between two parties and hold the Conservation Commission request or hold the buyer hostage because of the Conservation Commission. I don't like the precedent we may be setting, and I would be opposed to including that in any motion. I think we should grant the manager permission, and we'll make that a motion to grant the quitclaim deed to Parker Brown, provided the back taxes and interest be paid to the date of closing.
I'll second that.
Okay. All right, discussion. Yes, Lester?
I just want to say that I agree with Councilor Tinsman.
Okay, Michael?
I just want to clarify one point that make sure there's no misunderstanding. We have actually leaned the property and we have foreclosed upon it. And it has a number of liens and a number of foreclosures. And it has been owned by the town since the late 1970s, early 1980s. I just want that understood.
Okay. Any other questions, discussion? Penny?
Could we act on it end of July or something like that? You're the precedent you're afraid of is that ordinarily on a regular council meeting, when this isn't a council agenda, we usually grant the quitclaim deeds. And your concern is that if we do not, because we want the Conservation Commission to have some input, we will be setting a precedent that is unfair and opening ourselves up for some liability.
Well, I think if we screw up the deal because the Conservation Commission wants too much, then could we be held liable from Mr. Brown? I don't know that we could, but I just think that as a normal course of business, we don't interfere in issuing quitclaim deeds if the monies are there to pay it off. Otherwise, we would have perfected the lien, asked Mr. Brown to move out and actually take possession of it in the real sense. And I feel uncomfortable getting in that position now if we haven't acted on it over the last 10 years. And I just don't want to interfere. I think in good faith, if they've been discussing conservation easements, great. I think that's good, but I don't think we as a legislative body should interfere with that.
Okay. Yes, Lester?
I've always supported the Conservation Commission. In fact, I used to be on the Conservation Commission, but I think if the Conservation Commission wanted it at this point, they could have bought it if it's been for sale. I think the time for the Conservation Commission to step in is after maybe a developer or something had bought it, and see if they can work like they have on other projects and maybe get that
Okay, Bill?
I agree with what Lester says 100%. I don't think we should be holding up anything, as Doug said, and for the Conservation Commission to make their decision. I think we're here to clear up a problem with Packer Brown, and if he has somebody to sell it to and the sale goes through, then that is when they should come in.
Is your motion seconded, Doug?
Yes, it is.
Yes, we're discussing the motion right now. Is there any further discussion? Are we ready to vote on the motion? All those in favor of the motion? Any opposed? Okay, motion carries 7-0.
That was to authorize the town manager to execute the quitclaim deed.
Yep.
We had a problem with one of the banks once that the motion wasn't precise enough. So.
That's exactly what it was.
Good.
Okay, item 129 is to consider supporting the establishment of a sister city relationship between Archangel Russia and the Greater Portland region. And we have a representative from the Archangel Committee who has been very patiently awaiting a chance to make a presentation tonight. And I'd like to ask Dan Glover if he would talk to us about this sister city.
Does a man get the best chance to go? Is that the idea?
We're already taking dibs on the trip over, so.
Good.
So let's
good.
Get right down to that.
I got promise.
I get to go. Considering the time you took on items 124 and 125, I hope that the discussion of a U.S.-Soviet sister city relationship doesn't take nearly as long a time as the subject might deem necessary. I talked with Mike before coming over, and he thought that you all would like to know why a U.S.-Soviet sister city and what role the town of Cape Elizabeth might play. I passed out a flyer to you all, and there were some available to the people in the audience. But the flyer doesn't explain some things. There is an organization called Sister Cities International, which plays the key role of formalizing U.S.-Soviet sister city relationships on the part of the United States, and an organization in the Soviet Union called the Association for Relations Between Soviet and Foreign Cities. These two organizations agreed on a couple of guidelines that would determine which cities in the United States and the Soviet Union might be paired. And one of their original requirements was that the population base be a 200,000 population minimum. That has since been lowered to 100,000, and the Soviets have been agreeable in talking about populations less than that. But when I started working on this a couple of years ago, the parameters were a population of 200,000 people. And the second stipulation that's critical to you is that all the municipalities within that 200,000 population area must agree to this U.S.-Soviet sister city relationship. In most 200,000 population areas, the normal situation is that someone is talking to one city to one city council. But in the case of Greater Portland, we have three cities and eight or nine towns that would have to approve a U.S.-Soviet sister city relationship between Greater Portland and whatever that city is in the Soviet Union. And the city that we have targeted is a city by the name of Archangel. Why the Soviet Union instead of Australia or Italy or France or some more appealing place has been a question often put to me. Well, you know, why does anyone want to pair up with a city in the Soviet Union, especially one in the colds of the area of the Soviet Union like Archangel is? Archangel is just below the the Arctic Circle. Thank you, Steve. Just below the Arctic Circle, and it is a cold place. But there are many similarities between Archangel and the Greater Portland area. The major industries of Archangel are wood, pulp, paper, and lumber, shipbuilding and repair. It's the basis for a fishing fleet, and those are many characteristics that you find familiar here in Greater Portland, and as well as in the state of Maine. Also, some of you might remember, and from reading history, and some of you may have been part of it, but during World War II, Liberty ships were built in South Portland, and most familiar is the city, the port city of Murmansk, but also the city of Archangel was a recipient of those Liberty ships. Beyond that, why the Soviet Union? I attended a lecture last Wednesday night at the University of Southern Maine, and the professor speaking was a professor of economics from Brandeis University and the Harvard Russian Research Center. And one of the things, well, the thing that he was talking about was the winds of change in the Soviet economy. And he gave a list of 10 different major changes that have been instituted in the Soviet Union. I won't give you all 10 of them, but I'll read one of them to you. Production enterprises will no longer be assigned quotas by the Central Committee of the Communist Party. They will be encouraged, that is, the industries will be encouraged to compete and determine their own targets, their own quotas. This is to be phased in by 1990. Now, he also said conjunction with that that Hungary has similar laws on the books, but they've been trying to implement that for 20 years and haven't been successful. This is the first time the Soviet Union, as a federal body, has made a significant change like that in their economy. So I guess the point is, and Professor Berliner prefixed his whole talk with when they were thinking about the title of the lecture that he was going to give, and Winds of Change was suggested. He had in mind that maybe those were very little puffs of wind, not gales of wind, but this last change that I just read to you happened in the latter part of June in 1987. So the changes that are happening in the Soviet Union right now are quite significant, and I think that the why the Soviet Union now, I think that now we have an opportunity to help the Soviet Union in the changes that they're making for themselves. What role Cape Elizabeth will play is difficult to say at this point. I think the general answer to that question is that Cape Elizabeth can play as large a role as it wants to play in this sister city relationship. The first thing that we would need Cape Elizabeth is to endorse the concept of a U.S.-Soviet sister city. And then beyond that, in 1988, in September, there's going to be the third annual conference of U.S.-Soviet sister cities. And someone, or no more than two people, from a number of cities in the United States will be invited to that conference. But there will be no more than two people per city. Who will represent the greater Portland area? At this point in time, I don't know who it will be. And whether or not anyone from the greater Portland area will be invited will depend upon the speed with which we get endorsements from the towns and cities in the greater Portland area. But the conference will be held in Tashkent, Uzbekistan, which is a bit warmer climate than Archangel, but a very interesting international city, which is paired up with the city of Seattle, Washington. We are working on right now developing some kind of a due schedule for those organizations who at first endorse it and then become members or donate to the organization. We don't know what that due structure will be for municipalities. We're going to try to make it as reasonable as possible so that so no one will be choking on the amounts of money that we'll be looking for. But certainly a sister city relationship is going to involve some cost. And so we'll be coming back at some later date saying that we would like to have some money. It won't be necessary if we structure the organization the way it is headed. Hopefully we'll be self-sustaining financially, but certainly if you think it's a good idea to have a U.S.-Soviet sister city, we would like to see some money behind your good wishes. The focus of the relationship is education. And beyond that, you can read into it anything you want. But what the purpose of the sister city relationship is to understand something about the Soviet Union, in specific the city of Archangel, if the city of Archangel chooses to pair with us, which we don't know that for sure yet. But the focus is education. When I was out at the second annual U.S.-Soviet Sister City Conference in Seattle, Washington in May of this year, they had a high school group playing chess with their counterparts in the Soviet Union. And that's something that cost some money to set up, but minimal. They had a personal computer, was hooked with another computer in the Soviet Union, and they had four kids from the United States or from the local high school who were playing four kids from a local high school in the city of Tashkent. So there are a number of things that the city of Cape Elizabeth can involve itself in. That's a very small example, but some of those things do cost some money. So the question of money, if you're going to come to that, and eventually certainly you will, in my mind at this point is not the major issue. The major issue is, does the town of Cape Elizabeth believe that it's important for the greater Portland area to be paired with a city in the Soviet Union? And I'll be glad to answer any questions you might have.
Who has the first question? Has the city of Portland discussed this at all yet?
The city of Portland has discussed it in their sister city committee. They're currently paired with Shinagawa. And they have some concern that they don't want to dilute the effort of their Japanese relationship. But we are trying to assure them that this is a greater Portland effort and not just a Portland effort. We will be meeting again with the Portland Sister City Committee at the end of August, and hopefully from there go to Portland City Council sometime in September, but that remains yet to be seen.
Would you continue with the project? Even if the city of Portland?
It would be difficult without, but we already have the city of South Portland endorsing it, the town of Gorham. I'll be talking to the Westbrook city, one of the council's committees next 2 weeks from now. And I hope that Westbrook will be endorsing it. I think with enough endorsements, we won't need Portland. It will be a little awkward without them, but we hope that they'll be persuaded to endorse it. I think the initial round of endorsements, we're looking for an endorsement of the concept, and I think ultimately they'll find it difficult to refuse an idea that might improve relations between the two countries, but that remains to be seen.
Yes, Penny?
I move that we consider supporting the concept of establishing a sister city relationship between our USSR and the Greater Portland region.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Yes.
Yes, Bill?
I see the Cape Elizabeth School Board has already endorses it.
Yes, sir, just within the last 2 weeks.
Now, if the town does it, the school board does it, do we have two units involved here?
For educational purposes, maybe.
Right now we're concentrating on all school boards and all municipalities in the greater Portland area. And the more official bodies that endorse this, the more weight the organization has. And that there's a duplication within any one municipality is no problem, but in fact just reinforcement that it's a good idea.
Now, have you talked of any bucks at all?
Excuse me?
Possibly, have you talked of any money at all?
To the school board?
To the school board or to any other organization? I know you said at this point you don't have to, but you should be thinking on it.
The South Portland Kiwanis has already given $1,000 to the project. The South Portland Chamber of Commerce has already given $300. We just filed for nonprofit status at the end of June, and we won't be officially a nonprofit organization until later on this year. And we are still in the process of developing a scale of how much it will cost to become a member. We've just recently had a person volunteer to be a treasurer, so we're in the very early stages of fundraising, but absolutely we've thought about the requirement of finances, but we feel that we can generate those through a number of different avenues.
Thank you.
Yes, Nancy?
Penny. Your motion was kind of tentative. I recall, you said consider endorsing the concept.
Consider the concept.
Do you mean
supporting?
Endorse?
Supporting. She didn't mean consider.
Yeah, I was just reading from the agenda item, and I used the word concept because that's the word that he used.
Yeah, and I agree. I think we should support the concept.
Right, to support the concept. Yeah. You're right.
Yes, Doug?
Bad word.
Well, I hate to be the pipe over here, and I don't want to be banished wherever this place is for saying it.
You don't want to go?
It's cold, I know. But it's probably not foggy, so.
Cold.
I'm really not very excited about this. And I'll tell you, I'm not sure I could endorse it. I don't want to deny the opportunity, but I really, without knowing what it's going to cost the town of Cape Elizabeth to be involved both as a school endorsee and also as a town endorser, I just don't know what the costs are. And I'm not very turned on to the whole idea right now. And I just, without knowing what the people in town think, and it's relatively easy to find out, this was something I just noticed Friday in the agenda package, and I'd like to think about it before I voted in favor of it. I may not be on the plus side when the vote is taken, but I may have to register my.
So
yes,
whatever it might take to get a unanimous vote would be appreciated if it meant waiting till August to get a unanimous vote. The two councils who have voted so far have voted unanimously. We'd like to maintain that record. A majority vote would be certainly, I'll go home tonight and be thankful for that. With regards to what it will cost Cape Elizabeth, again, it will cost Cape Elizabeth what Cape Elizabeth puts into the project. If the school intends to involve itself to whatever extent that it feels it wants to, they're going to know what those costs are when they proceed to involve themselves. And I can't stand here and tell you, I can tell you it costs around depending on where you get the tour package, anywhere from $1,200 to $2,400 to tour the Soviet Union for 2 weeks. And so I don't know what it's going to cost you, and I don't, you know, in a month from now I wouldn't know what it would cost you, and in a year from now I won't know what it would cost you. All I can tell you is that the project will cost some money, and it's going to cost money based upon how involved you intend on getting into the project. If your schools want to get involved and they want to send two or three or six kids over, or if they want to host a half a dozen kids, I don't know what those costs are going to be. But the organization isn't going to pay for that. The organization is going to try to facilitate and organize that type of activity. And work with the local communities who want to do something like that, but what those things are going to cost and who's going to bear those costs, it'll be up to that organization who wants to involve itself and to what extent, and it'll be up to them to come up with the money, as it would be up to Cape Elizabeth to come up with. If you wanted to send the mayor to Tashkent, Uzbekistan in 1988, it's going to cost somewhere around $2,400.
It wasn't the mayor, I was thinking.
Well, whomever you'd like to send.
Why do you point over this way? And the word is banish, not send.
Well, you know, Douglas, I really feel that we need to raise our horizons and broaden them after arguing all night about the access to Crescent Beach.
No, I...
You know, I am delighted to think about our tangle.
It's our angel.
Russia. It really clears my mind.
My concern, I guess, would be with organizational costs within the committee.
Well,
regardless of our involvement of sending or banishing one of the members of this board, what would be the organizational cost of your committee just to be on a holding?
We've put together a pro forma budget of $40,000. For 1988 and $40,000 for 1989, picking the numbers fairly out of the sky, but that's basically going to pay for one person and whatever printing and advertising, telephone and that type of thing will it involve. And I don't think those are large. That's not a large number for the greater Portland community to address, a $40,000 number, and come up with that somehow. The South Portland Kiwanis came up with $1,000 this year. There are, I think, eight or nine different Southport, or not, there are eight or nine different Kiwanis clubs throughout the area. I'm going to be talking to Scarborough Rotary Club on August 4th, the evening, and the Portland Rotary Club that afternoon, and looking for money from all those types of organizations, but also from membership, and we'll be filing for grants from appropriate places, from businesses, and we'll have business memberships as well. So there are a number of avenues where we can come up with the financing. But that'll be the problem for the committee to do that, to keep itself afloat. If you're looking for your direct cost, then again, that'll be up to you.
I'm still concerned if this membership consists of no more members than what's on this list, which it may very well be. I mean, if you don't get any more endorsements, the membership will be on this list.
If we get no more endorsements than that, then it won't work.
But we're involved with our school department, we'd be involved with that town.
Mm-hmm.
And if our costs are going to be $2,000 a year, then I would like to know, if I'm voting to become a member of this committee, that our cost is going to be $2,000. If our anticipated cost is going to be $100, then I would certainly look at the whole situation much differently.
I've talked to John Walker about some numbers that might make sense for each municipality, and we're talking about a number less than $1,000 at this point for any one of the communities to become a member. It might be $250 or $500 or $750, maybe, depending on the size of the community, or depending on a number of different factors. We certainly wouldn't want to not take more money than was prescribed. But we're going to try to prescribe a membership structure and dues fee that is digestible by all those parties who are concerned. And again, that will be just part of the financing necessary to finance all the different types of activities that will go on. But the committee itself will be a core committee that will have its own budget and generate its own funds, and then those activities that are happening outside of the committee, that is sending students to the Soviet Union or vice versa, will be had to finance on the basis of that, on the merits of that project in the marketplace by itself.
Just to try to allay Doug's fears a little, so we can't have a unanimous vote, which I understand the real implications that you want to derive from total unanimity. I think it will have greater clout when you're discussing it. You're just going to ask us for certain recommendations for money. You can't force us or put a gun to our heads, or, you know, you're going to say this would be nice, and if we want to vote him 10, we'll vote him 10. 1,000, we'll vote him 1,000. This man isn't saying we're going to be legally bound to paying. That'll be another debate maybe that we'll have about how much we want to support financially. Maybe some of the committee want to support a little bit more than others. But we're not entering into any kind of a legal bind here, and I hope that you would really be amenable to voting yes so that we could have the 7-0 endorsement of a very, very interesting concept, people to people, to bring world peace, which I am very excited about. I'd like to be on the record as saying. So, anyway, okay. Did that allay your fears any?
Do you want to respond to that? Go ahead.
No, it doesn't.
It's always the first word that's the most important.
And I'll tell you, if you're trying to organize something that's new, then you try to anticipate what your membership is going to be. It's like going to the bank with a proposal. You can at least target what your membership is going to be, and at least target what your municipal cost could be. And I'd like to see that target before I just adopt something that we're going to be financially committed to if we go into this. We're not going to become a member of the committee if we're not going to commit funds, whether we vote him in tonight or not. And I'm only concerned about the dollar number.
Okay, Penny?
I'd like to withdraw my motion and hope that the seconder, whoever it is, will withdraw their motion. I'd like to delay item number 129 to be taken up again as an agenda item at the August 10th meeting. The only thing I can hope is that he will have been to the Rotary Club, you will have been to Scarborough, or are there any municipalities you're going to between now and August 10th?
No, ma'am.
Don't withdraw the emotion.
Well, yeah, I'm not going to withdraw the motion.
Phil, did you have? another phone?
No, I just want to say that I think Doug can draw figures out of a guy better than I can, because I asked if there's going to be a budget, and I understand conversation that they had discussed budgets. And I am one that's concerned how much this is going to cost the town, what you could do it. And the more numbers you have, I'll admit, she'll be a lower fee. And like Frank says, he can't hold a gun to your head. I don't think anybody can hold a gun to a head. Even the greater council of governments can't hold a gun to a head for that fee. So I don't quite look at it as strong as that. I feel that we can put our money in, or we don't have to. The school board would probably put theirs in, and Cable Elizabeth still be a member. So they have two choices here in Cable Elizabeth to get their bucks.
Anyone else?
Tonight we're looking for an endorsement to the idea of establishing a U.S. Soviet sister city between Greater Portland and a city in the Soviet Union. Tonight we are not specifically looking for any amount of money. I assume that the question of money would come up. To that, I have no concrete answer. I don't think I would have a concrete answer in 1988 or even 1989 what it's going to cost anyone who is involved with this project, because the amount of money it will cost you will be relevant to the amount of involvement that you wish to commit yourself. The membership dues for belonging to the organization on which you are not voting tonight will be spread around all the municipalities in the Greater Portland area. I don't expect those membership dues to be more than $1,000 for any one community unless they wish to vote on some larger than what we anticipate will be their assessed
voluntary
amount.
Voluntary contribution.
Well, I mean, it's certainly going to cost some money, Mr. Tinsman. I mean, there's no doubt about that. But I'm not asking you to put the town of Cape Elizabeth in debt by any large amount. Whatever the amount that Cape Elizabeth puts into this project, I think will ultimately you will get back in due course in many ways, not financial.
One more question, please. What are you hopeful as far as the number of members in this? What do you look for? 150? 200?
Greater as far as municipalities?
Yeah. No, municipalities and also other organizations.
Well, we haven't developed any real hard, fast scenario on numbers, but we're looking for all the municipalities, all three cities and eight or nine towns. I think there's eight or nine. As many nonprofit organizations that are in the city, if there are 50, we want half of them. I can only give you some guesstimates on what's out there and what we anticipate getting. Individual memberships, 1,000. 2,000? I'd like to see 25,000. I mean, it's certainly a reasonable prospect, but at this point in time, that's really, it's a far-fetched number from where we are right now for us to be. If I said, yeah, I think we could reasonably expect to have 25,000 members by next year, I'm kidding you. You know, I don't know that.
Ready for the question.
Okay. All those in favor of supporting the concept of a sister city relationship with Archangel Soviet Union? All those in favor? Any opposed?
I'd like to go on record by saying that I didn't mean banish. Okay, I meant, like just visitor or something.
All right, the motion carries almost unanimously, but not quite. 6-1. Thank you for your presentation. Okay, item 130. To consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding proposed new subdivision regulations. Frank?
I defer to the town manager.
Oh, sorry. Yes, Michael.
This is something that the Planning Board has been working on for about 2 years, particularly quite a bit of staff work by the town planner. of late, particularly over the last 6 months, he's been working very closely with Tom Leahy. They've had a number of meetings on discussions of these subdivision regulations. I found out on Friday afternoon, much to my surprise, that there had been continuing meetings between the town attorney and the town planner, but not on the final draft. I certainly had the impression that they had met on the final draft. They hadn't. Tom Leahy had some objections to this draft that some may have been aware of. Unfortunately, they weren't related to the ordinance committee. So therefore, I believe it would be in order to refer this back to the ordinance committee to hear from the town attorney as to his comments on it.
So move with one comment. I think when the audits committee met, and I just want to point this out right now, because I got to keep my eye on it, that we had quite a discussion on scenic vistas. And if I remember Steve Butler saying, that was a pretty hard thing to regulate, and it was going to be stricken from this ordinance. And I see it's still in with the copy that I got.
That is obviously not the final draft, though. That's one thing to keep in mind.
I understand that, but I just wanted to point it out.
Certainly discuss that at the ordinance committee level again.
I move
it was not my recollection that it was stricken, no.
Oh, was it?
No.
Oh, because you wanted it.
Well, but this isn't the final draft.
Okay, anyway, Bill, you have moved that this be sent back to the ordinance committee. Is there a second?
Seconded.
Okay, is there further discussion?
Yes. I would like to express my extreme disappointment in the turn of events here, where we have met twice as a council with the planning board, and then once at a very long, detailed meeting with the ordinance committee, and then come to find out on Friday afternoon at 3 o'clock that the proper legal input hadn't been given when we had just about touched every area other than my specifically asking that, which we assumed all along, given the number of meetings that we had. I just find this to be a major oversight, and I'm very disappointed in the staff that prepared this and to have this happen. And I would certainly hope that it doesn't happen again, and I can assure you, as chairman, the very first question I'll ask it from now on will be, has Tom Leahy given his input? And it's very, very upsetting for the amount of work that the committee members and I, as well as fellow councilors have done. So I don't understand the level of professionalism as it's been shown here. So.
Hey, your point's well taken, sir. And I'm sure that that word will be brought back to the appropriate people.
Yes, it will.
Any other comments? All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Okay, item 131 is to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding a proposed floodplain ordinance. Frank?
This one fly or this one canceled?
This is not going to be a 1 hour one, I can tell you that.
Is it canceled out?
1 minute?
No, it's not.
I didn't know the other one was canceled either.
Yeah, no, the next two go. Thank you, Madam Chairman. This was passed, as the councils will remember, as an emergency ordinance at our last meeting. Since then, the ordinance committee has had time to meet to discuss this and go over it in depth. What this does is bring our floodplain ordinance up to date and gives it further substance. Basically, what we're doing is giving stringent standards to building on the 100-year floodplain. In other words, if you're going to build within the 100-year floodplain, as it's defined by the various maps, this gives you the mechanisms and the proper procedures by which to build. It talks to such things as permits, to development standards, certificates of compliance, and you may ask, why do we need to bring ourselves up to date in this technical a fashion? And the answer is, in order to such that people who live and build on that can qualify for low subsidized federal insurance, which is very important. And as a matter of fact, I think we're all fairly surprised to hear that it was between 400 to 500 properties that this would qualify for. So certainly, we have a number of residents that are very interested in making sure that we are up to specs on this particular ordinance. All maps, as we've asked the town manager to look into, are up to date. We're all meshed in with the state planning office and FEMA. And thus, here we are presenting this before you.
Are there questions on this? Are you ready for motion, Bill?
I move it be approved.
Second.
And set the public hearing?
Yes, I'm
August
sorry.
10.
August 10th.
August 10th. Town Hall, 7:30.
Just have one question. Frank, at our last meeting, Frank, we were given this floodplain ordinance and kind of rushed it into emergency ordinance because of the time frame and the insurance problems. Have you or your committee changed any wording or the essence of that
from our last meeting. Do you propose any changes?
We didn't propose any changes. In fact, the only two areas that were discussed, you know, it was all discussed section by section. The only two that brought out any discussion was page 4E, where it says that the building inspector shall issue a two-part flood hazard development permit for elevated structures. That's going to be two-phased. That's been talked about with Jerry Daigle and Ernie McVane. They're going to be doing that. And then the second part was on page 12, which discussed no land in a special flood hazard area shall be occupied or used. No structure which is constructed shall be improved until a certificate of compliance has been provided to the building inspector. And then it tells how to get that certificate of compliance. Those are two areas that Steve Butler worked with Daigle and McVane on making sure we could do.
Okay. What's been the planning board review of this ordinance, proposed ordinance?
Michael? They reviewed it prior to it coming to the council. It was initiated by the planning board.
Okay. So it was their work that came to us the last minute. Okay.
Yes, Lester?
If this is going to public hearing next month, will we get a new set of ordinances? I didn't realize it was in last month's packet where I wasn't hearing all. I may have thrown it away.
We sent that to your...
Be happy to send fresh copies for everyone.
They recycled it while it was on there.
Okay, any other questions before we vote on this motion to set this for public hearing for next month? Okay, all those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? The motion carries unanimously. Item 132 is to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding proposed amendments to the sewer ordinance relating to the Board of Sewer Appeals. Frank?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. As you've had time to review this, you'll basically notice that what we're doing here is changing the Board of Sewer Appeals from 5 to 7 members. As we discussed in our committee, why bother to do such a thing? Answers that came up that seemed very relevant were it's easier to handle absences, conflicts of interest, vacations, and to keep the continuity of the committee going with this size. I guess this has been the experience that we've found from a number of town boards. The second and more substantive change revolves around the dual jurisdiction of this committee, which is now defined, number one, as it makes decisions on appeals, et cetera. So that's the quasi-judicial jurisdiction of this committee. And then secondly, it will advise the town on issues relating to the sewer ordinance, sewer extension, and on other matters. So I guess you could look at it and say, this will become the ongoing sewer committee, sewer advisory committee into the future for the town. So it has the dual functions. That briefly, as you can see, those are the two major issues that are before you that are underlined for change, and that concludes my report to the council on this particular amendment.
Okay, yes, Nancy.
Also, it provides for staggered terms. Mm-hmm. For continuity.
That's right. Lester?
Yeah, I move that we set this for public hearing on August 10th,
1986. All right, any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Did you vote, Doug?
Yes.
That carries unanimously. Item 133, to consider extending the Sewer Advisory Commission members' terms from July 1st, 1987, from the scheduled expiration on July 1st, 1987, to September 15th, 1987.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Sir.
This would be until the new Board of Appeals is in effect. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, 7-0, Debbie. Item 134 is to consider authorizing the town manager to execute an agreement with the Portland Water District to extend a water main onto Hanford Cove Road. Michael? Yeah, Doug?
Yeah, Pat. Just like to bring it to the council's attention, as I did previously when it was brought up, that I do live on Hanford Cove Road. I do not see that this is a conflict of interest, and if necessary, be willing to give my reasons why I don't feel it's a conflict of interest, but I would like the council to determine whether it is or not. And I would ask that if anyone has a problem with me living on Hanford Cove, other than taxes and other things like that,
but be in a conflict of interest. Or if you'd like to know what my reasons...
Why you think you don't.
Okay. Okay, first of all, I guess, a conflict of interest would be where you have something to gain out of the ordinary, or if you feel it's a conflict of interest. I think that's probably a crude definition of it, but I feel that where I have good potable water currently, and no danger of losing that, where I live within 500 feet of a hydrant currently, and where I have no plans to sell my home or otherwise profit from the installation of deep water, that it's not a conflict of interest.
Any other conflicts? Yes, Penny?
I believe that Councilor Tinsman would inform us if it was a conflict of interest. I'm going to accept his reasons that it is not a conflict of interest.
Any other Councilors? Lester?
On this subject, mm-hmm. I have nothing on this subject.
Okay, Nancy?
I just have a question. This agreement made this 28th day of May, 1997. You're going to change the date?
Yeah, we'll do that with a pencil amendment.
I thought okay. You were talking about Doug Tinsman's.
Right, yeah. First of all, I'd like to have a consensus from the council as to whether they feel Doug has a conflict of interest.
I have no problem with him voting on this.
Hearing none, then.
I disagree with him as far as I think he has something to gain. I think deep water is better than a well, and I think he'll increase the value of it. But I don't think it's negligible enough to warrant a conflict of interest.
I don't think it's any different than those people having sewers go by their house and on the council.
Or new roads.
Okay. All right. You're off the hook. Okay.
I've got a question on the agreement. Have you gone to the agreement?
Yeah. No, we haven't, but would someone like to make a motion on the agreement, then we can discuss it?
I move that the authorized manager to sign the agreement dated this 13th day of July. Is that the date?
Yes.
Second.
Okay, now discussion. Yes, Lester?
A couple of things. Has Hennepin Cove Road been surveyed so that you know whether the pipe is going to be on private property or town property?
I have no knowledge on whether or not the water district has surveyed it for this purpose.
Secondly, I think they promised that we would have that done in 3 weeks' time. Do you have anything? I can't see anything in here where it says they would do it in 3 weeks.
That is not in the agreement, and my past experience with contractors and with utilities, I don't believe in having meaningless provisions in contracts.
Well, I think it's more than meaningless. I think those people deserve to have the project done as quickly as possible. It's a very narrow road, and they're going to have difficulty entering and egressing. So I think if they said they could do it in 3 weeks, we ought to hold them to it.
Yeah, I agree it should be done as quickly as possible, but I you know, my past experience with putting date certains in a contract is it just doesn't get done. You know, certainly, you know, if you wanted to put that in there, it could be put in there, but, you know, you always question enforcement. Yeah, I'm not too sure.
Well, you can penalize them. You can penalize contractors, and I don't consider this any different than a normal contractor. They're going to do the job. They're a contractor, and I think you could penalize them for being overextended on time.
You know, Lester, we put in all these roads for the sewers. We fixed the hill on Ocean View Road. We've never done that. I'm not saying that we shouldn't do it now, but we've not historically done it. We've never set any precedents for doing it. And trying to collect penalties on this kind of a project,
The district is offering us this water main. They have not thrust it upon us. It's something the town requested to be looked into. You know, I think that they're fairly favorable terms to the community. I think it provides a very important public need in this particular area. And I think, you know, the district has given every indication they go in there and get it done as quickly as possible. You know, I take them at their word. You know, certain the problem with 3 weeks, you know, it just may not happen in 3 weeks. Bad weather, a whole number of things. You know, if you want to put it in there, it's certainly something we could then see if the district would agree to, but I'd feel very uncomfortable in forcing. But if you so wish, I'd be happy to.
Phil?
I don't think it's necessary, and I think it's something a water company is going to work in with their other work. If they get a break somewhere else, they'll probably pull off of that for a day or so and fix their other problems. And I think it's a reasonable figure to get the water down there, and I feel that we should move forward with the agreement without putting a penalty in there. Penalties are damn hard to collect for, and you can get more arguments on why they couldn't do this, they couldn't do that, and you held them up for this, you held them up for that, and I think it just creates a hassle. I have one question with number three. The Town of Cable agrees to issue to the district at no cost a street opening permit covering this work. The town also agrees to be responsible for the paving replacement costs arising from the project. Who is responsible for the settling of the trench in between the time that the water company fills it back in and we get ready to pave it?
The district.
The district. You think that should be in there? If you come some Saturday, Sunday afternoon, and it's settled in one spot right deep, do you call the public works or do you call the water company?
Call the water company.
But then I think it should be in the agreement here.
Doug?
Okay, that's all I have.
Okay, I just have two minor questions. The first one is will you know when the work will begin? I mean, some of the questions I've had in the neighborhood have been, when is the work going to start? Is it going to be consistent with using the summer water so that we can shift into a deep water in the winter? Is it going to be in the middle of winter? And second of all, is the construction, as they more or less stated originally, going to allow for summer hookups to continue?
These number of different questions. As to specific schedule, the district is waiting to schedule this until the town gives its final go-ahead. They have told us that it will be early fall, you know, just as soon as we tell them when it is. It would be my intent with this project, and the district has agreed that we do exactly as we did with the sewer project, and that's to have a meeting inviting everyone in the neighborhood to it, explaining exactly when everything is going to happen, if they have any concerns, who to express them to, et cetera, so that everyone's totally familiar with the schedule. Secondly, the issue of the water main, the summer line, that will be discontinued. Part of the credit on this project is what it would have cost to replace that line, and they gave us a total credit for that in requesting.
Yes, I understand the summer line will be discontinued because you have deep water, but will there still be access points within that deep water main for summer hookups? In other words, will there be stubs run for summer hookups off the deep water main? And I believe they said there would be. And I'd be very concerned if there wasn't. And I know that that's not in writing. And I would just like to shore that up.
I'd have to find it out.
Yes, Lester?
Well, again, I'm concerned with tie-ups. That's a very narrow road. And I'm wondering, there's nothing in here that says that they may have that blocked off for days of them if they want to. There's nothing in here to say that what they're going to do to prevent that road from being blocked off for fire rescue or people getting in and out.
They have to maintain one-way traffic.
Does it say that here?
It doesn't say it here, but every other town construction project, you know, that we don't have formal agreements with requires one-way traffic. You cannot obstruct a public way and not allow people to get out of their neighborhood. You know, that's common sense.
Good.
You don't need that in an agreement, is what you're saying?
No.
Okay.
Did we have that in any agreements with the sewer construction?
We did in a number of those agreements, yes.
Okay. because that is important. Does anybody in the public, from the public, have anything they want to say? I know there are a couple of residents from Hanover Cove that waited the last minute.
My name is Henry Berry, and I live on the corner of Hanover Cove Road. And when this was proposed and there was a public hearing on this, we were told, and I sent a follow-up letter because I don't know that there was anything included in the minutes of the meeting, so I felt I sent a follow-up letter to make sure that, and was assured that my letter would be included with the minutes of that meeting, that what was said that night orally would not be lost, that it would be recorded. And we were told that night that this would be completed within 3 weeks. That was represented to the assembled residents of Hanover Cove Road. And the gentleman from the Water District himself stood right over here and said that. And I think that a performance bond is not at all uncommon in the construction business, that a performance bond is done in most contracting. It's an everyday thing, and it does not have to be acted upon, and certainly the town is going to be reasonable, and if they're a few days late, fine. But if they're 4 months or 5 months instead of 3 weeks that they represented to the assembled residents of Hanover Cove Road, I think they ought to be responsible for a penalty rather than the residents of Hanover Cove Road having to suffer. And I think the town should be in the position, and the town manager should be authorized to insist on that in a contract. You're representing the people of the town. That's a representative form of government. And I think that the people down that road should be entitled to that consideration by the town. You're negotiating an arm's length bargain here, and I think that that should be part of the town. Another thing was that the road would not be moved. The blacktop area would not be changed at all. That was promised that night. I understand that that is to be so. Is that right?
What does that mean, changed?
Well, the existing blacktop, that's correct. That the existing blacktop road is, they're not planning to change that at all. Is that correct?
Any narrower or any wider.
Right. Go ahead, Michael.
Mr. Berry, you did send a letter following that last meeting.
That's correct.
You were sent a response, I believe, from the council chairman, whoever it was, I'm not sure, but it was Mr. Tinsman, saying that it would be made part of that record.
Good.
That letter very carefully came back to you. It did not agree that everything that you said was in fact true, because in fact some of the things you placed in your letter were not formally agreed to by the Portland Water District. You included things in your letter which was never discussed at that meeting.
I heard myself.
I want to make that clear to you tonight, so that you don't, when the construction begins, bring the letter back to us saying it was all agreed upon. It's simply your view of what was agreed upon. And I want to make that clear.
Well, I would like
so it
to
doesn't
make,
become a problem later on.
If I'm to be allowed to be heard, Madam Chairman, before the council, I would like to make it clear that I myself sat in that room, this room, and heard the man from the Water District give an estimate of 3 weeks. And he said within about 3 weeks this will be completed. Now, if you want to make it 4 weeks, fine. And if they have to be called off for a couple of days or the weather is not good, fine. But don't make it 4 or 5 months or a long period of time beyond that, an unreasonable length of time beyond that. And I think you ought to set some time limit that would be a completion date, and beyond that they ought to have to pay a penalty because they are the ones who are contracting to do that. And they did, through their representative, say that. And I said that in my letter, and it is true. I don't care what anybody else says. I heard it with my own ears. And as far as changing the road, I understand that that is not proposed. Is that correct? That the blacktop is going to be remain the same as it was?
The width of the road is not.
Okay, that's all right.
It's not going to change. And, I mean, I'm not saying the blacktop's going to be exactly.
No, no, but the width of the travel portion is not. Is not all right. And as far as any damage, then I assume that the town is insisting that liability coverage be provided by the Water District. Is that right? From blasting, or I don't think that's been specifically mentioned tonight. I assume it's in the contract. I haven't seen the contract, but I just wanted to mention that I think it would be appropriate for any of the residents to be covered for liability coverage if the Water District or their agents through blasting caused any damage to the property along the way. Thank you.
We require any contractor in the town to provide liability.
Good. I think that's appropriate. Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else from the public? Okay, if not, what is the desire. Do we have a motion? Okay. The motion is to sign, that's right, to sign, to authorize the agreement with the change in the date, and that's the only change being proposed at this time.
No.
What was the other change?
Of the settling of the road.
Oh, that's right, and the settling of the road.
Is that correct, Pickle?
Nobody asked me if.
No, that's true. You mentioned that, but that was not, not added.
It's not a formal part of my motion.
So you don't feel it should, is necessary, is that what you're saying?
Well, if you want to put that in, Bill, would you make a motion to amend the original motion?
You want it done that way? I'll move that. We amend the original motion to have in there that any settling problems within the construction project will be taken care of by the Fulton Water District.
Okay, is there a second to that amendment?
Is that okay, sir?
Michael?
That's fine. Perhaps to ease things a little bit, to authorize me to have an agreement with the district that has all those things in there, plus four additional things. One is that the district is responsible for trench maintenance completely. Number two, that they continue to provide access points off the deep water main for summer hookups. Number three, that the road be kept essentially the same as it is now as to width. And number four, that it is our understanding that the work is expected to take no more than 4 weeks, and that we expect, you know, reasonable progress and et cetera, et cetera. And to have the agreement have those, the final agreement have those four provisions in it. The council's willing.
I agree with it. Do you want to have an amendment, or do you want to have their?
No, why don't you move those changes?
Make the whole thing.
Those four changes, if you're in agreement with all of them. Would you be willing to do that? Is there a second?
Second.
Okay, is there any further discussion? Okay, we'll vote first on that amendment. All those in favor? Any opposed? Penny, did you vote? You voted in favor, okay, 7-0. Okay, now the original motion. Now with the amendment. All those in favor of the original motion? Okay, that also passes 7-0. Okay.
We got the big law, I mean, we got the agreement, we got to the water.
Item 135. Item 135 is to consider the appointment of a town council member to serve on the comprehensive planning committee. A couple of people have expressed an interest from the council in serving on that committee. I will entertain at this time any motions to appoint a member to that committee. Lester?
I move that we appoint Penny Carson to that committee.
I'll second.
Okay, is there discussion? All those in favor of the motion? Any opposed? Okay, the motion carries 7-0. And thank you, Penny, and I hope you would be very open to entertaining any proposals that council members would like to have you bring before that committee.
I think the council should go over their comprehensive plan. Certainly maybe not the September meeting when the organization is being formed, because the appointments may be meeting before then also, but certainly in the early first couple of meetings, and jot down some of the ideas that they'd like to bring forward.
Okay.
You know, just prepare so that I have it in front of me.
Fine. Okay, item 136 is to consider the appointment of a representative to serve on the PACS policy committee and take any necessary action. I'd just like to say that Mike McGovern has been working for some time to get Cape Elizabeth represented on the PACS committee on an annual basis. As it is, we've had a rotating representative, so that there are years when we are not represented. And because of the fact that he has worked so hard already on this committee, and that most of the members of the PACS policy committee are managers, I'd like to propose that we ask Mike McGovern to serve on that committee, and he said that he would be willing to if we would like to have
so
a second. Any discussion?
Yes, why does Poland get three reps? Everybody else only get one.
Because of their population.
Oh, come on.
Because they give out.
Why don't South Poland get two then?
So
Oh, Portland voted against this membership for that reason.
Okay. How about Westboro?
It was
I think it's unfair, but I vote in favor of the government.
Okay.
Ready for the question.
All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. Motion carries 7-0. Item 137 is to consider a request from the Portland Water District to install a water main in the cul-de-sac at the end of Running Tide Road. Michael, do you want to explain that further?
I think you have the plan before you can see where it is. I think this is fairly standard.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Are you going to the TV?
Okay, item 139 is to consider scheduling a workshop meeting.
38.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought we had already done that. I'm sorry. 138. To consider a request from the Portland Water District to install a water main on Hanover Cove Road. Now, we have agreed to the agreement. Yeah. This is to give them permission to install the water main.
So we'll assume, Madam Chairman, that my conflict of interest still does not exist.
Right.
Well,
if it didn't exist when we allocated the money, I don't think it exists now.
I see that in the agreement there, the Portland Water District, this goes back to the agreement, have the right to run some laterals or whatever you want, their own discretion.
And do what?
With the permission of the property owners involved.
Oh, yes, I understand that. So they might want to connect two ends together, I understand. At a future date.
I move that we approve the installation of a water main down Hanover Cove Road.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Now you just
pass the 7-0. Now, item 139 is to to consider scheduling a workshop meeting for several reasons. I think we really do need a workshop meeting by the end of this month. One is the Crescent Beach chemical problem that we've discussed already today, tonight at great length. Also to view the Spurwink Marsh. We talked about doing that during good weather so that we can respond to the Rachel Carson proposal. And let's see, there were a couple of other items.
Kettle Cove.
To look at possible transfer station operations, salt use, and a question that we brought up during budget time having to do with the sealer of weights and measures. That's still an item that we haven't gotten to and we need to discuss at some point. So if we could lump all of those things together in a workshop meeting. And I'm open to suggestions as to when would be a convenient time. Yes, Doug?
Madam Chairman, I would hope that in the range of discussions that we have, that we could start out with the Kettle Cove situation, and that letters be sent out to the commercial fishermen and known users of that area so that they may be allowed to attend that meeting or at least be notified of that meeting. I can do whatever I can to work with Mike to make sure notification or Lester, that notification is made, but I'd like to have that first on the agenda, because I would anticipate some fishermen to attend and I would want to keep them here till.
Okay, if this is a workshop session, are you saying that you would like to have some input from them first before we come to any kind of consensus on what we want to do there?
I think in order to understand the situation, we need to understand the people who use the area, and that in a workshop, hopefully we'll come online with what we need and then we can go back to the state for some sort of a meeting with them. I think the workshop's important to have input.
Okay, I think it would be important to have input also, but it shouldn't be limited to just the fishermen.
I don't think it should be limited to just the fishermen.
He didn't say that. He said anyone that.
Huh?
He didn't say that.
I thought he did.
Anyone that might have an interest in that.
Using it. So therefore, you've got to go out to a lot of people.
You've got to notify a lot of people.
I think we're getting into the area now here of a public hearing versus a workshop, and I think we should really define the two. I see a workshop as us exchanging ideas. There's other times for input, one of which is the public hearing here,
and when we set it to public hearing, I mean, there's two times I can discuss it here, or we can have a public hearing, but to combine the two, I am not, I don't think I'm in favor of it.
I would also like to request that we have a legal reading on the May to November section from our town attorney. It may be premature to hear from the fishermen until we do get a legal reading on that. I don't know that we can discriminate against recreational users when you're talking about public access to state waters.
I just like to point out why I was concerned about it to Councilor Tinsman is, what about the people there that aren't fishermen that go down there and they use part of the beach or they use a launching pad there that the fishermen use to go over to Richmond's Island on a Sunday, Saturday, overnight and things like that. I think you've got, and this is what I would call recreational, I think you've got to hear from
That's
anybody.
What I'm
I don't
about.
Think you can't take just one group.
And I'm not trying to discriminate between the occasional user and the known users of Kettle Cove. What I'm saying is that this council, in my opinion, doesn't really know what it wants down there. In order to come up with a reasonable plan, you've got to consult the people who need to use that area. And those people who need to use it are the fishermen. And if we just forget their input, then we'll be talking in circles like we've been talking for the last
I don't think there's anybody on this council doesn't agree or realize that the fishermen need that area. And I don't think I need any one of them to come up here and tell me that we need this and this is what happens. I think you and Lester relayed it pretty well. And I think you're just going to take up an hour or two at a workshop to hear the same thing over. And I don't want to deny any one
Let
of them.
Come to the public
I think we should sit down and discuss and find a way that we can work with the recreational people and the fishermen.
Okay. Perhaps that would be the way the workshop would work, but I would think that the fishermen need to be told that their future is being discussed by this council. And if the town doesn't want to put out a notice that we're going to be discussing this in a workshop, then I will do it myself through a little paper and I'll put it on everyone's windshield. But I would like the fishermen to be part of the discussions that we're going to be having concerning their future. And whether it's a town function or not, they will be notified. And I'm not trying to discriminate between the part-time surfboard user or anybody else, but I will notify the fishermen that we're having a workshop, and I want everyone to know that.
I think if...
Sorry, I would like to say again that I feel that we need to vote, if you feel that strongly on it, as to whether or not we're going to have a public hearing, then use town monies, not have you put them on windshields of fishermen, town monies to tell all the citizens that we are going to be discussing access to parking about Kettle Cove, access to the beach, etc. We can't, you know, I haven't participated in one workshop since I've been here, and I would say thankfully, where we've had one after another person come to a microphone and speak. I have participated in those, and we call them public hearings. Yeah. And I would be very strong in my vocalizing that. The distinction between the two need be made.
Well, I do think that there are two things here, and that if the council feels that a public hearing is necessary before we have our workshop to discuss this, then we could do it that way.
I think we should have the workshop first.
Yes, Lester?
It's my belief that the workshop is public. I don't think we can go into an executive session as a workshop. So I think
that's right. But it's a workshop.
You could advertise in the paper that you're going to have a workshop on this particular thing and let them come.
That I'll buy that 100%. But for somebody to give out a specific notice to certain few people, I think is wrong. If you're going to make a notice, you should pass it to everybody and not just a certain few.
Okay, but as a concerned citizen, I will let the fishermen know definitely that there'll be a workshop, and that is an open session. They're invited to come up and listen and participate if they find it necessary. And the town does not have to make a special effort. That effort will be made.
Okay.
Is that agreeable with everyone?
As long as the information is fairly and evenly distributed, that's the only point I have to keep emphasizing. We can't tell one sector of our community about it and not everyone else. So if it's
right
through the newspaper, however, we fairly get the word out to everyone so we can hear all sides of this story.
And really, I think we should remember that a workshop is for our benefit, and that we need to do a lot of discussion during that. It's not a time for us to sit there and hear reports and have input from all kinds of people. It's a time for us to do work that has to be done. If we really feel the need for a public hearing, you know, that's another route to go and give everybody a chance to speak. But I don't think that the workshop is an appropriate time for that.
That's why I'm still leery. I mean, I may be the only one left that's leery, but I'm still leery. I could see, let's say it's like any other explosive issue in town, that we have 30 or 40 people that come that want to speak. Mm-hmm. See, I don't mind that, but that no longer is in any way, shape, or form is a workshop, let alone one that now has 5 items on the agenda. So I just want to make sure I don't, you know, we don't come prepared to do certain things and then other things happen. That's all.
Okay, could I ask that this be brought up first in the workshop, that the Kettle Cove issue be first?
Sure.
Are we going to try to get someone with authority from the state, like Herb? No?
Not at the workshop.
Not at the workshop?
What I hope is that Herb will come down sometime between now and then, and he, John, and I, and Chief Pickering, and can go down there, talk things over, weigh things back and forth. But, you know, I think for Herb to come to a meeting of the council when the council is still going off in many different directions, might not be the most fruitful thing.
Don't you think it's a good idea to get Tom Leahy to look over that?
Yeah, I've got that listed. So
I do.
Okay, can
really
we talk about possible dates?
No, I just want to say one more thing.
Okay.
Are we going to have a notice in the paper that there's going to be a public workshop and what is on the agenda?
That's good. It says meetings and it lists out the meetings and what the thing is.
Steve.
Workshop on blah,
yeah.
Blah, blah, and blah,
right.
In the what's happening this week thing.
That's right.
Are we going to have it?
Of course.
Steve says yes.
Okay.
We'll hold you to that.
Because
right.
Because if he's going to make a special effort to notify the fishermen, which I agree it's okay, I think we should make effort to notify the recreational people so they can both hear both sides of the problem while you're sitting here. Because I think that's what you could turn this into, is a public hearing.
We'll put it up on the fire department sign.
I still think we're in the wrong area here. We're in the wrong, I'll just say that because I really believe that. We're in the wrong area. We're talking about either a public hearing or a workshop, which is certainly open to the public. Certainly open to the public. But when you invite, you start to invite comments, that is a public hearing. And we're missing the point.
Right.
At a workshop, anybody can raise their hand and say,
right.
We're discussing, and I'd like to comment, certainly bring a comment, but not that everyone comes with prepared statements to make. You know, our democracy has a place for that. It's called a public hearing.
I agree.
And that's all. We're either deciding here. I'd like to keep the workshops in the context that I've known them since I've been on the council. They've been very productive and excellent, and I want to keep that context if possible. So I think we should vote on, do we want a public hearing on this issue or not?
Frank, I'm not asking for a public hearing, and I don't want to beat this thing to death. It's getting late. It's an open workshop. It's open to the public. I've been told countless times that we're discussing issues that affect their futures, and they're never notified. The last time we met with the state park, we didn't even announce that we were having a workshop. We just met, and it was not fair, and they felt slighted. I'm surprised there weren't a couple of them here tonight knowing we were going to discuss a parking issue, but again, it was disguised as a traffic ordinance. I will tell these people, because I see them daily, that we'll be discussing in a workshop that they're invited to attend, the discussion centering the launching of boats at Kettle Cove.
Why would you be adverse to having a public hearing to start the evening, which usually lasts an hour to hour and a half, and then us adjourning into a workshop? What's wrong with that? That would be amenable to me. Then we could do it in a more orderly and equitable fashion, where all members of the community, for the cost of a $200 little notice, all members of the community are notified we're having a public hearing on one of the key areas of town, Crescent Beach. What's wrong?
I'm not sure that these would be blown up into a public hearing, Frank.
You just said that fishermen, who are one of the major constituents of this town, feel slighted by the town. This would be a way that we could...
They ought to be advised that we are having a workshop discussing launching and hauling in of boats at Kettle Cove. That's all I suggested. I suggested that perhaps the town would go to some extent to let that be known. If If the town does not want to do that, I will just tell them it's not a major deal. They're invited.
You want to notify them other than public notice?
I will tell them. I see them. I will discuss it with them. I will tell them there's a workshop, and they are absolutely invited to attend and listen. They're invited to comment if they decide. I don't think they'll even say anything, Frank, but I want them to know that we're discussing their future. That's all. I don't mean to blow this out of proportion. It's not a big deal.
There's just many sides to the coin, and as Billy's pointed up time and again, there's the recreational person who might have something to say. There's the average citizen who just walks onto Crescent Beach who might have something to say. I can't right now for the life of me see why this doesn't necessitate a public hearing. Or if we're going to have a workshop, what's the big deal of having a public hearing an hour before? What is, you know, by 8:30 we're into workshop session and we've given the citizens an opportunity to express their views. I think it's a very appropriate issue to have a public hearing.
If you want to have a public hearing, go ahead. I'm not opposed to that. I'm just saying it doesn't have to be that way.
Tonight.
We'll have another one.
I move that we put a notice, not an ad, but a notice in the paper, thanks to our fine reporter, and that it be a public open workshop, but that we devote it to discussion. By George, we're going to be talking all night on that issue of access to the waters at Crescent Beach. That's a motion.
What's the date? 27? Let's move on.
Well, let's try a couple of dates. How about Monday, July 27th? That's 2 weeks from tonight.
What?
Monday, July 27th. How about August?
It's fine with me. Monday, July 27th is fine with me.
Me too.
Me too.
Now, is this a public hearing?
It's a notice.
I believe it should be a public hearing. I will not vote for this motion because I believe it should be a public hearing. Then we adjourn into a workshop. That's what,
Frank,
I firmly believe.
You had a public hearing tonight. You're going to have one after we revise.
No, this is to get input in an equitable fashion. Not just where Doug, and Doug can talk to any citizen he wants to. Doug can go talk to the fishermen. Billy can go talk to the farmers. I can go talk to someone else. That's all us contacting, and that's good. That might work. I feel a healthier way. We've allotted some money in our budget to have Michael send out notices to public hearing. I don't see at all the downside of that. It won't tie up more time. It ties up very minimal money.
Yes, it does.
And it formalizes the process more, where you all say what your piece, and now we're going into workshop. We've done it before.
The only problem I see is that we don't have anything to present for people to react to. We don't have a proposal. We're just saying, okay, here we are. Tell us what you want us to do with Kettle Cove. It's very hard, I think, for people to
I think a presentation could be made by the chairman as to the pros and cons of the issues. And I believe there have been other public hearings where we haven't had definitive things we've put forward. We've just said, here's the pros, here's the cons. What do you say? So I don't know.
Frank.
I'm surprised we're also against the public hearing.
No, I am not against public hearings. Let me just point something out. What if Tom Leahy says that May through November section discriminates because it mentions particularly farmers and fishermen? It doesn't mention the ordinary person or the recreationist. What if he says that? Then we look like idiots asking the fishermen and the farmers to comment on something that's illegal or unconstitutional.
We don't have to ask
them to
comment on that specifically.
I think we have to hear from him first.
I just think there's an equitable way to let the public know, other than just expecting the Portland Press Herald and Steve to put in a little blip, and then we're at their, you know, whether they'll put in the blip or not, I don't know. You know, we've been in this position before. I'm not going to depend on the Portland Press Herald for something like this.
But usually when we have a public hearing, we're asking.
I mean, they're extremely consistent and always do a good job. However, anyway, that's my opinion.
What's the time of the public hearing?
That is not my motion.
Right. That's not your motion. That's not your workshop.
Listen, I brought this all up. Just forget what I said, all right? I'm the one that started this discussion. Just forget it.
I think you brought up an excellent point. Which is going to be a big discussion amongst the citizens of our town, the citizenry of our town, access to Crescent Beach.
But you know, Frank, you and I differ in the fact that recreational people would like to use Kettle Cove. the fishermen need it. And that's the difference between this being just a casual hearing or a casual workshop and something that I think is very important. That's the only difference.
I don't disagree that the fishermen don't need Kelco. I think they need it as well as anybody. I think the recreational people should be able to sit here and hear the problems of the fishermen and not load this meeting with just fishermen, and you're not going to accomplish anything. This is all I'm trying to say. You should have everybody and not have one side.
You tell them.
Right. And that's done at a public hearing.
Oh, good.
Have a day.
All
right. July 27th. Is anybody opposed to that date?
What is it that we're having on July 27th?
All right. We're having a meeting. Right now we have before us a proposal to have a workshop on that evening. All those in favor of a workshop on Monday, July 27th at 7:30?
Just a workshop.
Yep.
All I'm opposed. I've been saying, I'm on vacation right now.
Wait.
It's all right.
Okay,
you
let's
go
finish
ahead
the vote.
Have a public hearing.
Let's finish the vote.
Okay, well, we haven't.
You haven't voted yet.
Yeah. All those in favor of the motion?
Sure.
This is for the workshop. All those opposed?
Wait a minute. I didn't vote on either one because I just have a small moment.
Well, wait a minute. Nobody's seconding the motion? Wait a minute. We don't have a second on the motion, Debbie tells me. Would anyone like to second Nancy's motion?
I didn't make a motion.
She opposed her own motion. I want everyone to know this.
Yes, she did.
She opposed her own motion.
Oh, the motion to have a
workshop.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were voting on the date.
Well,
I'll second Nancy's motion to have a workshop.
Oh.
All right, all those in favor of, I added the date.
Yeah, but, okay. Well, that's all right, I'll vote for it.
All those in favor of the motion to have a workshop on July 27th?
7:30.
All those in favor? 1, 2, 3, okay, all those opposed. All those opposed. Okay,
well,
the motion carries 4-3.
I'd like to speak as to why I oppose, because I was in favor of a motion. Maybe there was enough confusion here that we just need to say it. I would be in favor of a motion where we had a public hearing, then a workshop. I'm not opposed to a workshop that evening. I'm in favor of one. But I would, perhaps now I could make a motion that I move that we have a public hearing to precede the workshop on that evening.
Second motion.
Wait a minute. Didn't the other one just pass?
Yeah, I did. You can still have one to precede it.
Only if you're on the majority side. You can't change the motion.
It's not being changed.
It's not a real motion.
It's being altered.
We're still going to have the workshop. They voted to have a workshop.
We'll have to precede 7:30.
Yep.
What?
We will.
Yeah.
I think, you know, in the past, we ran into a situation like this somewhat before, and I forget what the issue was. We had something, we didn't call it a public hearing, we called it a public information
Commerce,
session.
That's right. This is,
and we got the word out through the fire department sign and through other mechanisms, saying, you know, the council's going to be discussing Kettle Cove. Come forward with any concerns that you have, period, and just see what comes out. And, you know, it accomplishes that. It gets you away from, you know, that you know better than the people involved themselves.
I take umbrage with that statement. No one is implying in any way, shape, or form we know better, and I don't. And every way you just described of getting the word out to the public, I find inefficient. Okay? An efficient manner is to proclaim a public hearing and send out little notices, as we've done in the past and budgeted for in the town budget.
Right. Send out little notices to
you don't send out little notices
to the entire public hearing.
Haven't we done mailing?
No, you put it in the paper.
Or we could put it in the newsletter.
Yeah, my intent is, there's not going to be a newsletter between now and then. Right. My intent is to put on the fire department sign, to buy an ad in the newspaper, and to put it on the cable TV informational channel.
I think what you should do on all that is to say we're going to have a public hearing on it, instead of come bring your comments to a workshop. That's silly.
The batteries haven't worn out. It's on TV tonight.
I'm a little confused.
No kidding.
I just don't know procedure.
I started it all.
Is this all for the, this is all going to come about to present proposals to the state and what the citizens of Cape Elizabeth would like to do with Kettle Cove?
It's for the council to hear, to talk with among ourselves, the kinds of things that we then would like to talk about with the state.
The state in developing.
Together, developing a plan for it. We don't have to know what our own ideas are first before we can tell you what they are. But we got a little bogged down here.
As they stand right now, as the fishermen have access to the beach, they have access to the ramp. And what you're trying to do is see if there should be more public use allowed on the beach and at the ramp.
All the issues we debated earlier this evening.
And we're coming from everywhere. That's the problem. We don't seem to be very much in agreement.
I think we need to work on what we want a little more, if I may, Madam Chairman. We want to try to come up with something that would be consistent with what the state would find reasonable, I think, for access to Crescent Beach and Kettle Cove. So
okay.
I think as a member of the public, you ought to attend. But I'll put a notice on your windshield.
Do we have a second to that bill's motion? Did you make a motion to have a public hearing prior to the workshop?
Frank made it, I said.
Okay. Is there any, yes, Les?
Yeah, I'd just like to know what the public hearing's about. You usually have a packet or something that says what the public hearing's about. I don't understand how you can have a public hearing and maybe not vote on it.
All we have to do is replay the tapes of about 4 hours ago and the one-hour debate that went on in this chamber regarding that particular amendment and all the issues that brought up. Who is going to be allowed access? Are windsurfers going to be allowed access? Recreational vehicles that want to fix their boats? Commercial? What's going to be the ramifications of if we move the recreational boats out of there? Are they going to go over to where the fishermen's boats are and clog them up? If a proper moderator of all these issues could bring this to a head.
So you're going to write this down and hand it out then and they come into
no,
it over?
No. You just say that this is a workshop concerning parking issues at Kettle Cove. The chairman then makes a statement, thank you very much for coming. We are here to discuss a variety of things concerning Kettle Cove, some of which you're interested in. This is what they are. We've discussed parking, we've discussed access, we've discussed who the people are, to lay it out and then listen to the people.
Maybe even, you know, explain to them some of the proposals. Like, here was an amendment that got tabled tonight. What do you think of it? I mean, that's the whole idea of getting public input, right? We don't always have to say we're real clear on exactly where we're going. Sometimes we can turn to the citizens and say, we're not real clear yet. We'd like your input on it before we get clear. So that's, to me, it fits hand in glove perfectly. But
okay. Are we ready to vote on this? All those
I'm not clear about the time, though. We have a workshop starting at 7:30.
If this passes, I would ask those that sponsored that particular motion to be amenable to having the workshop after the public hearing, which could start at 7 or 7:30. Obviously, okay.
I would just say that there is a procedure for voting, and I'm not sure we're following that proper procedure. Maybe the manager could enlighten us. I think we're...
I don't understand you. I'm sorry.
By a majority of 4 to 3, we adopt to have a workshop at 7:30 on the 27th. And now we're going to have a public hearing. Well, we've already scheduled, by a 4-3 vote, a workshop.
If the same council votes to vote in a public hearing, we can be amenable enough amongst us to see that is also the will of the council. Thus, we would like to be flexible enough to have both the same evening and make it convenient for the citizens. That might not be the exact letter of the law, but we can be flexible enough to come to some agreement on that.
Well, we may be holding an improper public hearing, Frank.
Let's vote it up or down.
Why don't two members...
I move the question.
All those in favor of the motion to have a public hearing before the workshop on July 27th?
5-2.
And 2 opposed. Okay. Now, what time should we set this workshop up? Why don't we set it for the public hearing for 7 o'clock? Is that all right?
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody have any problem with that? Okay. Right.
Would it help everyone here if I made a motion that we adjust our workshop to proceed our public hearing, being a member of the 4-3 vote? And got Nancy to second that. Would matter? They've done it.
I don't think it really matters. The chairman is responsible for handling the difficulty.
I think we're
when one runs over.
Okay.
Okay.
We'll move on to item 140. Item 140 is to consider revised throwing church regulations.
Is it
long?
Michael?
Yeah, the regulations, the only changes are on the second page of the provisions to use.
And what it amounts to, we've had problems with vehicles not getting out of the parking lot, particularly if there's also wedding receptions for a call. They want to leave their cars at the church, and that causes tremendous problems for the next wedding. There's also a provision here that said if they're going to have more than 25 people, they have to have rehearsal. Rehearsal is the opportunity to go over all these rules. When they don't have a rehearsal and don't go over these rules, we have found that everything is going every which way the next day, of the day of the wedding. So I would encourage you to approve these provisions for use of the church.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
Yes. Is this a change in the fees?
No.
The fees are the same?
Fees are the same.
Any other questions? All those in favor of the motion? Any opposed? Okay, motion carries 7-0. Item 141 is to consider a proposed amendment to the MMA risk pool contract agreement. Michael?
Majority of the communities in the pool have already adopted this, so regardless of what you do tonight, it makes no difference.
Move this question.
It only works to our benefit.
What a preamble.
We have no reason to oppose it, I would say.
I'll move it. Second it.
Well, we could make a statement.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries 7-0. Item 142 is to consider entering into executive session.
So moved.
Second. Give the reason for personnel matters.
Personnel matters.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Could you give some directive to the cable television people?
Yes, I will. We will be moving into executive session at this time, and I think that our camera crew can cease televising at this very late hour. And thank you very much for your late attendance.
Can Debbie go home?
Yep. Can Debbie go home?
Debbie can go home.
Can we turn it back?
The lights can go off.